So one of the things I tried to highlight in my presentation was that, you know, in the field of energy, you know, you can make a decision to go from a incandescent bulb to a CFL, and you can save 40 or 60%, and the LEDs are coming. But if that light is off because no one is in that space, you've saved 100%. And right now, to turn the lights off in your house, it's a matter of, honestly, it's a conscious decision, a very high level. I'm downstairs, the kids are downstairs, I bet they left the lights on. Mm. You gotta go back upstairs and turn them off. That's taking time away from your day. That's a physical action to do that. It causes that your house should be smart enough for that just to work. So the analogy I like to use is your refrigerator. That light in there is only on when you need it, it's off when you don't, it's never annoying or disruptive, it just works, it's reliable. Why can't we do that to your house? You know, why can't your phone call ahead to your house, and as you pull in the driveway, the house is on and it's ready to go? And as you move around through the spaces, it adjusts how you're using. And that one tiny little example of what's going on in your space can stretch to every space that we're in. So often I'm giving a presentation and there's a coffee pot in the back of the room that is perfectly lit, you know, and people are taking all the notes in there. And your laptops are on and hopefully you're listening to me, and they should be in a more power saving mode. So sensing is about an awareness, is the word I like to use, of what people are doing with energy, and to use the brain to make a better decision for you so you can spend your time on the other things that are more important. Let's spend more time with the kids and less time running around the house turning lights off.
And so what do you find is the biggest barrier to adoption?
Right now, I think, you know, there's a lot of things. To me, though, it's the cost. You know, it's really, you gotta break this point where the cost gets so low. So we've seen it happen in consumer electronics. I think, you know, 20 years ago, we never would have imagined that elementary school kids would be going with their phone, you know, like that to school, right? And and it's not just the cost of that, it's the cost of the service behind it. Both of those things have reached a point where it's ubiquitous. So that revolution hasn't come to sensing yet. A lot of the same technologies I used to do my sensors and to communicate with the sensor information are just an extension of what the revolution in electronics has gotten us to this commoditized consumer space. And that's really where we're driving. How can we get into applications that drive the volumes up and the costs down to where these things just, you know, spontaneously nucleate? It just happens.
Is that what you were referring to as far as commoditizing? You'd use the word commoditizing in your presentation, which I found interesting, given that, you know, this is a very special project that you had up.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, there's, you know, you look again at your mobile phone. There are a whole lot of very inexpensive components in there that all come together to something that they're frankly willing to give you for free, as long as you have access to the service. And it's the information exchange that's important to you. For a little bit, that device is a status symbol, but for the most part, it's just a portal to your access to the internet now. And that's what needs to happen. So, you know, I use this is my little goal for what I'm trying to get to, which is something the size of a Tie Tech, has all the sensing capability you can imagine, a radio to communicate, a battery on board, scavenge energy from the environment. But frankly, and they hate it when I say this, it's gotta be about zero. I mean, it's literally, we gotta be able to give them away, because you are interested in lessening your impact on the environment through making your home smarter. The company is interested in understanding their footprint better and making a better decision. And the technology is just, hey, we just take care of that because the business case, that part, it's just a no-brainer. And that's where you have to get to in the technology. Right. So, you know, to cell phone, hey, I want to know where my kids are, I want to call, it's a no-brainer. And so we have to get to that point.
So what do you think, what's the biggest fear people have in using smart technology?
We, as HP, have an enormous number of customers worldwide. And we take the privacy of their information very seriously. Mm-hmm. As a researcher, where I'm trying to understand what people are doing, respecting that privacy is a fundamental core of how we're developing that technology. Mm-hmm. The other part is the security of the data. Yeah. You want to make sure that someone hasn't put in faulty data in there to get this automated system to respond in a way that's inappropriate. So there's a great movie came out recently called The Italian Job, where they go and they spoof the traffic system to enable their bank robbery. Mm-hmm. And you want to make sure that these systems can't react in a way like that. You know, that was Hollywood. But it's one of the things we think about. So privacy and security, I think, are the two biggest things, and it's fundamental to our research, is to make sure that your data is private. So I talked about in, you know, the meeting hall was very cold in there, and I talked about aggregating sensor data from everybody's phone to have the building understand better how to use its resources in heating and cooling.
Yeah.
I don't actually care who is in the room.
Right.
I just want to know what temperature they are. And that is the most important thing. I don't want to know who you're sitting with. Mm-hmm. It's irrelevant to using the resources more wisely.
Is there also, implied in what you were saying, is there also a concern of loss of control?
I've never heard it kind of phrased like that way. I prefer to think of it as there's a lot of menial day-to-day tasks we're moving into the computer system to give you literally more free time, but more time to use your time wisely, to be thinking about how to be sustainable and not running around,
right,
you know, doing the little day-to-day tasks. I had somebody ask me once that kind of similarly that if all of this, you know, being sustainable happens automatically for me, will I forget that it's important?
Yeah, that's great. Yeah.
You know.
That's actually on my list of questions.
Yeah, and I think it's actually a very interesting and valid point. I think it's, again, part of the information, and that's what the internet side of this is going on, is how can I show you that this system is making a difference, you know, mm-hmm. to give you an idea of, you know, your reduction over the year, and that we're maintaining it, or, you know, you had a big party last week, and here was the bubble, and let's think about your energy usage. It's an education thing. You have to, giving people the information, they will make good decisions, and mm-hmm. I think that's what we've seen as, you know, this sustainability mm-hmm. Has come to the forefront. You know,
right.
Give people a choice, educate them,
yeah.
and they can do that. And that's really what I aim to do.